day dawns on rural Australia, and this new day will shed light on the recent Royal Commission to whereby the Australian public witnessed firsthand the attempts by the banks and their agents to dispossess our Australian farmers and what measures they took to attempt the biggest asset for Asia grab in this nation's history. Welcome, my name is Rod Culleton, former Federal Senator of the 45th Parliament, and this is my story.
In July of 1999, the Howard government privatised the Australian Wheat Board. Prior to that date, the Australian Wheat Board was a government body which held and secured the single desk, which was the monopoly of trading the Australian wheat pool right around the world. Post July 1999, the new entity was known as the AWB Limited. That new entity had to look at how it could secure and set up a de facto monopoly and keep a hold of the growers and their products at the farm gate. To do this, they looked at two strategies. One was to bring out contracts that would write them right grain or get growers to commit to the pool. The second measure was in about 2003, where the AWB Limited purchased Wesfarmers merchandise. 2003 was the birth of the rural program.
The loan book is managed within two trusts, specifically the RWT and CPT, which are primarily funded by ANZ and Rabobank.
But in 2005, due to the assault being placed on the Australian Wheat Board, which was the oil for food scandal, another external funder came to the rescue, and that was ANZ Bank.
Food for the hard-pressed people of Britain. Food for the starving millions of the world. Australia's record wheat harvest is being reaped. The state of New South Wales alone will garner 115 million bushels of a total Australian yield of 230 million. There'll be an exportable surplus of 150 million bushels. Stan Carberry owns this property in the Narrabri district of New South Wales. Veteran of World War I, Carberry came from the city and was allotted 900 acres under the Soldiers' Land Settlement Scheme in 1918. He began with a tent, a couple of axes, and a willingness to work. Today, he is the most successful wheat grower in the Northwest, and his 900 acres have been extended to 9,000. Yes, Australia is truly a land of opportunity.
It's surely worth mentioning at this point that for a period of 60 years, the Australian Wheat Board was run, relatively successfully, by the Australian Commonwealth Government. However, it took only a mere 8 years from the time of the Australian Wheat Board being privatised for the new entity, AWB Limited, to find itself embroiled in scandalous dealings and infringement of UN sanctions, greedy selling food stocks to an enemy whom our own Australian soldiers were fighting against until its self-implosion and ultimate demise. All of this was in only 8 years, and in the time the loan book was established.
The Federal Police Task Force in the Australian Wheat Board scandal. The AWB crisis erupted in 2005 and led to a royal commission. The Wheat Board had paid hundreds of millions of dollars in kickbacks to Saddam Hussein's regime in Iraq. It was a severe embarrassment to the Wheat Board and the government of the day.
And the AFP has hit back at explosive claims from the officer who ran its investigation into the AWB scandal after he alleged he'd been offered incentives to make the case disappear. Back in 2005, the Australian Wheat Board was found to have paid out millions of dollars in bribes to secure contracts in Iraq. Ross Fusker was appointed to lead a federal police task force, but he says he was given little support and told not to pursue prosecutions.
There was just a general conversation about a variety of things, and And then he said that if I could make the task force disappear, I'd be the next coordinator.
Despite the controversy surrounding the new entity, AWB Limited, on the 15th of November 2005, AWB had to ring fence its assets and protect its growers, and did so through the creation of a new trust pursuant to a master trust deed, which would inevitably protect their de facto single desk monopoly selling. The master trust deed on the 15th of November 2005 spawned a number of subordinate deeds known as the supplementary deeds, which allowed for the external funders, both Rabobank and ANZ Bank, facilitate to be the external funders for the rural program. Thank you, Uncle D, for teaching me to love my bone guitar. Thank you, girl from Broken Bow, who shot an arrow through my heart. Thank you, Mama, for the roll, and thank you, Daddy, for the rock. Despite the controversy surrounding the AWB Limited and the invoking of a Royal Commission to look into the All for Food scandal, farmers went about their daily business. However, it must be noted that Landmark Financial Services, being an independent contractor and servicer of the rural loan book, continued to write interest-only loans up to 22 years, when in fact the manager of the loan book, AWB Limited, was in effect trading insolvent.
Winton in Queensland.
Yes, we've been at 42, 44 degrees up there.
I have seen the master trust deed. It is a securitised loan arrangement, complex. In 2010, when the book debts of Landmark were purchased by ANZ, then ANZ came in as the manager, and that's where the problems appear to have started.
The collapse of Lehman Brothers was over a securitisation scheme very similar to this, but on a much bigger scale. It affected the housing market in the United States and arguably around the world. This scheme, which affects only a proportion of Australian farmers, obviously doesn't have the same reverberation around the world, but it's certainly affecting the rural market for land.
By mid-2009, AWB Limited was caving in quicker than a prick balloon, and ANZ Bank had to make moves because it was at arm's length and in effect had become an unsecured creditor. On the 8th of December 2009, they entered into a sale purchase agreement. This was known as an incestuous trust, which was merely designed to take a full assault and perform financial terrorism on our farmers.
Controversial West Australian Senator Rod Culleton has quit One Nation.
Rod is a pain in my backside, to tell you the truth. I'm glad to see the back of him.
One Nation leader Pauline Hanson there live from Brisbane speaking about the resignation of Rod Culleton. Now, the senator, who's now an independent senator, Rod Culleton, spoke to the media in Perth a short time ago about his decision to leave One Nation.
Because I have come into the parliament, Pauline Hanson approached me. I came to the parliament under the policies. They were the policies that I believed were good policies to go forward in Australia and good for Western Australia. What appears to now have happened is that Pauline Hanson has tried to mow my grass in going out with a Senate inquiry, which was a two-pronged approach that I wanted anyway, and she's now diluting the Royal Commission when I've already put great terms of reference. They already know it's a crime scene.
The reasons why the Australian people want a Royal Commission is the very reason why the banks don't.
No, we're not having a banking Royal Commission.
It should not be about going to our government and simply asking for a Royal Commission. It should be the people's right to demand one.
No, we're not having a banking Royal Commission.
A parliament is not acting in the best interest of the Australian people if it doesn't listen. A Royal Commission or a reconstituted grand jury is inevitable, and it will happen.
There's not going to be a banking Royal Commission.
But there will be a Royal Commission. I mean, Malcolm Turnbull will call a Royal Commission, and if he doesn't, we'll go around him and go for a grand jury or go straight to the top.
On for years, it will cost hundreds of millions of dollars.
I mean, everyone in Australia wants a Royal Commission.
No, we're not having a banking Royal Commission.
and undermining, Mr. Speaker, an institution that is critical to our economy.
It will go on for years. It will cost hundreds of millions of dollars, and it will not tell us anything new.
You don't make it any easier, and sometimes the best way to describe it, you're like an old sheepdog, gets around my feet. I need to get on with the job. His decision, he was going away to write it, so he'd sharpen the knives, and he was pretty quick to use them. He was quicker than my local butcher.
And that he is still a senator. He also said that everything has been stayed for 21 days, and in that time, in his words, he said, I'll float on my back and I'll swim to the side of the rip. He says he's not panicking. He's going to consider his options and his legal avenues, but he's determined to fight it to the end.
But now, Mr. Steinberg, you've been put forward by ANZ to answer questions about ANZ's acquisition of the loan book of Landmark Financial Services.
Yes, that's right.
And also to deal with the way that ANZ dealt with the former Landmark clients.
That's right.
On the 27th of November 2017, questions were put on notice to the trustee of the Rural Program. Those questions were put forward as to whether ANZ, in actual fact, had acquired the loan book. It appears on the face of it, and a strong presumption, that clearly at least an inference can be shown how an external funder would repurchase back its loans. On the 14th of May of 2014, ANZ Bank's lawyers, Butler, McIntyre and Butler, wrote to a Landmark customer. As you can see at point three, ANZ lawyers claimed the following. Subsequently, ANZ refinanced PCL's lending to your clients. Because it was the beneficiary and funder of the rural program, there was no necessity for the ANZ to undertake any actual transfer of funds. If there had been an actual transfer, which there wasn't, then it would simply have been a transfer from the ANZ to PCL, the legal shell lender, and back to ANZ. ANZ held all requisite attorneys and authorities from PCL to provide a discharge of the PCL mortgage and did so. That statement is now shown throughout this program to be false. Under the Landmark credit policy, Landmark had a caveat of the safe lending margins, and as you can see, only ever advanced a percentage of perhaps up to 50%, or in some cases 60%, within the commercial lending, and as such, only ever entered into a joint venture with the farmer or the Landmark customer. On the 8th of December of 2009, ANZ Bank, through its actions, had created an impasse on the Landmark customer. The lack of authority in order for any person or named individual on behalf of the trustee in order to carry out the servicing rights pursuant to the terms of the master trustee and any subordinate deed, including but not limited to the Landmark Credit Policy Manual. It is clear that ANZ Bank, through its actions and its failure to reappoint authority holders, clearly breached the terms and conditions of the trust. It would be some months later that ANZ Bank claimed to have a new trust established and furthermore created a trust creation notice with a cut-off date on the 1st of March 2010. However, a power of attorney wasn't created by ANZ Bank in order to have the migration of the assets come over from the Landmark Trust to the new ANZ Rural Trust No. 1, and subsequently did not meet the cut-off date, and as such had no legal right to the assets.
Now, Landmark was a division of AWB Limited?
Yes.
And Landmark Financial Services was a division of Landmark.
That's right.
And Landmark Financial Services provided loans and deposit services to agribusiness customers.
Yes.
And in 2009, AWB Limited approached ANZ about ANZ purchasing Landmark's loan and deposit books.
That's right.
And on the 21st of October 2009, after a period of due diligence, ANZ's board considered a proposal for the acquisition of those loan and deposit books.
Yes.
Being fully forthcoming in giving information as to what is going on behind the scenes, they're relying on a master trust deed.
The loans from Landmark were held in a trust. Is that right?
That's right.
Which they say is confidential and can't be seen. In fact, their own legal counsel has said the deed is so confidential she's not even allowed to see it.
We see a summary of the findings from the due diligence that was conducted. And you see at the top of the page there under the heading Due Diligence Findings, due diligence has identified the following key issues, none of which are considered showstoppers. Do you understand what's meant by that, Mr. Steinberg?
I assume deal breakers.
I see. So these are the issues, the key issues identified in the due diligence process, but none of them were deal breakers.
That's how I understand it. That's right.
So one of the things that we've discovered is some of the loan applications that are being used by the bank are different from the copies that the farmers had that they had originally filled in. In other words, the figures have been doctored to make the loan look more attractive to Landmark or a third party or the investors or whatever. Well, the help was to go around with new contracts saying that you're no longer borrowing money from Landmark, you've got the money, but you actually borrowed it from the ANZ Bank.
And all these 4,000, approximately 4,000 signed in?
No, a lot of them didn't. Some of them became very suspicious, but a number of them signed in because they were basically forced to sign in by threat that the loans would be called up, that Landmark was out of business.
From that date, the 1st of March 2010, the former Landmark customers were customers of ANZ?
That's right.
Now, at the time of the acquisition, there were 7,124 loans in the Landmark loan book. You give us that figure in your statement?
Yes, that's right.
Now, following the acquisition in March 2010, ANZ sent letters to former Landmark customers about the acquisition?
Yes, we did.
And they were pro forma letters?
Yes, they were.
And I'd like to take you to one of those letters which you've exhibited to your statement as Exhibit 12. This is a copy of the pro forma letter that went to customers of Landmark that transitioned across to ANZ.
Yes.
We see the first paragraph there. On the 1st of March 2010, ANZ acquired Landmark's financial services loan and deposit book. So the customers were told by this letter that this was essentially a change in name only.
It says exactly what you read. It said that and that Landmark Financial Services staff had accepted roles with ANZ.
Mm-hmm.
And that they would continue to visit. Yes, I agree with that.
Well, yes, you agree that they were being told it was a change in name only.
Well, I'm not sure it says exactly that, but I agree with that it says what you read out, that it says yes.
I'm sure you agree that it says yes. What I've read to you, Mr. Steinberg. I'm asking you about what the person who receives this letter would have understood it to mean. And what I'm putting to you is that having read those two paragraphs,
yes,
the Landmark customer reading this letter would understand that this was a change in name only because the same people were going to be managing their accounts just under a different title. This time, ANZ was planning to, or already had, terminated the employment of a number of the Landmark rural finance managers.
I'm not aware that that had happened. No.
All right, well, can I show you a document, Mr. Steinberg, which is Exhibit 8 to your statement? So this is a document we see in relation to Project Conserve. That was the Landmark acquisition project, is that correct?
Yes.
And it's dated September 2009, so well before the March 2010 letter that I just took you to. You see there at the top of the page, so reminding you this is September 2009, based on RCNA customer management ratios, only 40 of the current 65 RM posts will be required. That was the case, that only 40 of the 65 landmark relationship managers were required to come across by ANZ?
Yeah, I accept that based on the fact that it's written there, yes.
Yes, so that was the plan in September 2009. Were followed.
I'm not aware of there being any systems.
Right. Should there have been?
Yes.
Thank you.
Perhaps more information around what they could have expected, but more importantly also in the manner in which the customers were transitioned from Landmark to ANZ.
And having acknowledged that you could have done this better, this communication with customers, what do you understand to have been the effect of the inadequacies of ANZ's communication on the former Landmark customers?
I don't feel that I can answer that question.
Examples of what you understand to have been ways that this inadequate communication affected former Landmark customers?
Can I have a moment to think about that, please? Thank you. As an example, I'm aware that some of the customers felt that ANZ didn't have the same level of agribusiness experience as the former Landmark staff had. So I think that's one example where they may have been, or they feel that they were affected.
Was that about your communication with them or about the nature of the experience that your relationship managers had?
How some customers may have been affected by the transition.
Yes. I don't want to labour the point, but I was trying to understand what you understood the effects of the inadequacies of the communication about the acquisition to be.
Yeah, and so the point I'm making there is that some of the customers felt that had they been advised earlier, they may have made a decision to refinance their facilities from Landmark before the acquisition occurred.
Yes, I see. Now, if a similar sort of acquisition happened now, what would ANZ do differently in its communications with customers?
So this is not a part of the bank that I normally work in, Ms. Orr, so it's a difficult question for me to answer.
All right, so over the following year after the acquisition, ANZ migrated the former Landmark customers onto its technology platform, is that right?
Onto ANZ's technology, yes, that's right.
And did that process go smoothly?
Not in all cases, no.
Any other difficulties? What about customers experiencing difficulties in opening their accounts as a result of the migration?
Yes, I'm aware that that happened as well. Yep.
And what about delays in responses to information and funding requests as a result of migration difficulties?
Yes, I accept that happened in some cases.
And did ANZ investigate what caused those issues?
Well, in the cases that I'm aware of, they did.
And what was the cause?
error by bank staff.
Isolated errors or systemic errors?
I wouldn't call them systemic, no.
Are we talking about a small number of errors or a large number of errors?
I don't know.
Do you know. So if a similar sort of acquisition happened today, what would ANZ do differently in relation to the migration of customers onto a technology platform?
Yeah, again, so this is not a part of work that I do, so I'm finding it difficult to answer that question.
All right. And from March 2010, ANZ began a process of re-documenting customers' loans out of the trust structure to loans that were written by ANZ.
Yes, that's right.
And what did that involve?
It involved undertaking a review of our customers' facilities, preparing a new letter of offer, an ANZ letter of offer, talking to the customer about the new letter of offer, also taking the securities onto ANZ as ANZ securities. That's what I think was involved.
Mm-hmm. And why did ANZ engage in that process?
It was for efficiency reasons. The view was that it would be more efficient to have all of our customers on similar terms and conditions, similar platforms. It was a decision taken by the integration team that that would be a more efficient way to manage that pool of customers.
More efficient for who, Mr. Steinberg?
More efficient for the bank.
But yes. I'm interested in whether ANZ calculated how many customers were going to experience financial difficulty and put a system in place to deal with the impending financial difficulty that those customers were about to encounter.
The documents that I've seen have all centred around calculating the overall dollar provision.
I understand that. So from a business perspective, ANZ was provisioning for this. What I want to understand is what ANZ was doing to deal with the human impact of what you were seeing in these documents, the fact that you were taking on all of these customers who were headed for financial difficulty.
Well, we had set up our usual processes and procedures that were available to manage those accounts. I haven't seen anything that specifically addresses the number of customers, and so I'm not able to tell you now how many of those customers.
And you knew it was going to happen over time, so did you start training your lending services staff in having the difficult conversations that they were going to need to start having with the landmark customers?
So I wasn't running this part of lending services at the time that this happened, so I can't speak of having any direct knowledge in that.
Well, did you start putting together a team within lending services to deal with your agribusiness clients?
Are you referring to the specialist team that we...
No, not talking about events much later on. I'm talking about, because of the knowledge that you had about the poor quality of the landmark loan book, whether one of the things you did in response to that was set up a specialised agribusiness team within lending services.
In 2010? No, we didn't.
There is a lesson to be learned from the landmark acquisition in connection with assumptions that were made around delinquencies and expected losses that were not stress tested. You see that, Mr. Steinberg?
Yes, I do.
Now, do you know what the assumptions are that are referred to there?
No, I don't.
You don't know what assumptions ANZ made in connection with the landmark acquisition?
No, I don't.
ANZ has put you forward to give evidence about the landmark acquisition, Mr. Steinberg. Are you telling the Commission you are unable to tell us what assumptions ANZ made in connection with the landmark acquisition?
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Well, Dr. Collins, your side chose this witness. What am I to do?
And under what sorts of circumstances does ANZ ask customers to enter into asset management agreements now?
So typically in situations where we've agreed with our customer that assets are to be sold in order to repay the bank's exposure, then it's possible in those situations we'll enter into what we might term an asset management agreement with that particular customer, again designed to outline a program of asset sales and at the same time outline the support to be provided by the bank in return.
Can you be more specific? In what circumstances does it happen?
There's no prescribed time for this to happen. These are decisions that are made based on the individual circumstances and using the judgment of the relationship managers and the credit officers who are managing that file. But there's no prescribed set of circumstances that point you into this direction.
Are there any criteria that need to be satisfied before this step is taken?
No, it's a judgmental credit decision made by the authority holders.
Would ANZ now enter into an asset management agreement with customers in the same terms as this agreement?
Again, it depends on the circumstances.
So it might?
It might, depending on the circumstances. We do look at these differently today compared to how we looked at them earlier.
To sell the property under this asset management agreement.
Yes.
I think you said ultimately that it was 2.5 months.
In accordance with this asset management agreement, that's right.
Well, I just want to make sure that you understand that the letter of offer that contained this document went to the Cheesmans partway through October.
Yes.
And they had until the end of November to sell their properties.
Yes.
The ANZ Bank was a substantial shareholder to the AWB Limited, and in fact had, in effect, 261 subsidiaries invested within the AWB. Since the invoking of the rural program on the 15th of November 2005, AWB Limited, being the originator and the arranger, had become listed as a troubled company in the Asia Pacific Reporter on the 7th of August 2006. This also was reflected in the AWB share price, and in fact, the share price was going down quicker than a grand piano being tossed out of a high-rise building. AWB Limited was in trouble. During this time, the independent contractor, Landmark Financial Services, through their managers, crossed the cattle grids and continued to write loans of up to 22 years interest-free into a book that was doomed for failure. ANZ Bank, being one of the external funders to the rural program, had also become subject to massive fines for suspected offshore transfers in relation to the conduct of the Australian Wheat Board. These fines also had been imposed for breaches of UN sanctions at the time. This brought the external funder, ANZ Bank, into disrepute, which was never disclosed to the Australian farmer. It is clear that the AWB Limited, through the rural program, had sold its loans long by offering facilities of up to 22 years interest only, and yet it had purchased its funding on a short-term basis. As we can see here, AWB Limited only ever had funding subject to tranches for only 12 months. Yet the grower, who was being offered the interest-only loans, thought that he had a secured financier with a trusted name for the period and duration for that facility. This was clearly not the case. It is clear that the AWB Limited and its external funders, both Rabo and ANZ Bank, could not continue to facilitate and provide facilities for the growers' loans post November 2010, and as such took measures to secure its assets to not become an unsecured creditor through the poor performance of the AWB Limited. Post the global financial crisis, ANZ and Rabo took extreme measures to dispossess our rural farmers on non-monetary defaults, and that was calling up the loans without notice and applying and turning up to the farms with receivers accompanied by law enforcement police officers to dispossess the farmers from their property.
This is, you don't like doing this part.
No. You know why? Because I've been through a fair bit of fucking shit myself lately. You know?
Yeah, alright, okay.
And I've got to deal with people like this.
Well, I didn't walk out of this job
because people fucking like you.
No, but hang on a minute. I didn't create the situation. I was going about my business. The other ones that fucking T-Bait.
Fucking going.
Good on you. Take him with you.
The actions taken out by our financiers was nationwide, and those actions fell far short of industry standard. In actual fact, crossed the criminal boundaries by their agents. The banks took all necessary measures because they were being paid a commission, or certainly their agents were, and they took all steps to dispossess our farmers from their land.
You took over this place. What would you do?
Suicide.
The bank manager's comments recorded while Debbie Viney begs him for ways to solve her financial crisis.
Clearly, they can't deny it. You have the proof.
Yeah, I got the proof.
However, the farmers were well aware that they were not in default of their facilities with their financier and had no option but to stand the ground and protect 5 generations of blood, sweat and tears and fought the banks head on and their agents and law enforcement at the farm gate.
But that would be a more efficient way to manage that pool of customers.
More efficient for who, Mr. Steinberg?
More efficient for the bank.
However, the truth will come out.
Chips got down. And this hurts me. Some things aren't easy to say. When the chips got right down, people, something bad happened.
A girl watching this speech up here right now in the public gallery tried to end it all by tipping 20 litres of petrol on himself and walked into an open fire. He was in a coma for 6 months, all because of the ANZ Bank.
I walked into a fire, an open campfire, and I poured 15... litres of petrol on myself. And I want you to have a look at what the happens when we allow our country to be taken over by criminals. Have a good look. Pardon my language. There's no kind of way I can put this.
Ma'am, you need to leave now.
I
understand you want to film. You need to leave now.
That
is police brutality.
You need to leave now. Okay, you've been directed, you've been warned, okay?
I'm leaving, yes, but
no, you're not.
Until my partner is off the ground and your policemen are off him.
He's now been arrested.
But however, the truth will come out. And a warning, what I have to say next may be a little bit distressing. If I had a choice of being publicly disgraced by the media or removing a loaded gun away from a boy's hand, I'd choose the first option again and again. I'd rather be humiliated than risk losing another life. I can deal with that. He shouldn't have to. During this experience, I have witnessed cases where receivers have violated farmers' wives, children's mothers, signatures forged. As a result, growers have an excess of $15 million worth of cattle removed from the property, and not one cent has gone off their debt to the bank, and yet they're still paying the loans. They have been stolen
by the bank's agents. One had the audacity to send the freight bill back to the farmer.
Really?
Yeah, really.
Really?
Well, he's totally resisting. He's going to throw him on the floor.
And that specialist team, you tell us in your statement, was established because it was thought that high-risk agribusiness customers would benefit from being serviced by relationship managers who had specific knowledge of and experience in agriculture and restructuring.
Yes.
Was the establishment of that specialist team prompted by ANZ's experiences with the former Landmark customers?
I would say it would have been a contributing factor. Just to give you some background, the germination of that team was all that came into being on the 1st of August. The planning for that team began in approximately March 2014 when we undertook a very material restructure of the whole lending services area. And as part of that restructure, one of the decisions we made was to create this agri team, and then there was a process that took 6 or 7 months from March until it was established in August.
Well, I want to take you to some documents to show that at that time, after this attention, ANZ started addressing the culture of the lending services team.
So again, Ms. Orr, I think that that is all part of this restructure that started in March 2014.
Mm-hmm.
So we had the big restructure in March 2014. We had the establishment of the agri team officially 1st of August 2014, but it actually probably took a little bit longer to get it up and running. Then during the course of 2015, we were looking at the purpose, the lending services purpose, or that could have been a little bit earlier, but all of this had its genesis from that restructure that was undertaken in March 2014 when we had a new general manager came along, and we were looking at doing the biggest restructure of a lending services area that I've seen in the 30 years that I've been involved in the area. It was a big change.